us today for the webinar on 12 new rules of engagement, redefining the employee engagement strategy in partnership with BI Worldwide. I am Ritu from People Matters, and before telling you about today's agenda, let me give you a brief about today's webinar topic. Times have changed. So are the ways in which your employees show their intensity towards performance and commitment at the workplace. Keeping in mind the changes happened over the last couple of decades, access to fast information, social media consumption, virtual connections, minimal, making large percentage of today's workforce, there's a definite need to relook at your strategy to garner positive business results. During today's webinar session, we will cover the following key points. Employee engagement, the new definition. We'll try to learn more to implement the new rules of engagement to realign your overall employee engagement strategy. Global trends from revolutionary employee survey. We have the privilege of having with us Siddharth Reddy, MD and CEO of BI Worldwide India. Siddharth and his team at BI Worldwide work with their clients in creating and sustaining engagement with their employees, channel partners, and consumer applying behavioral economic studies in understanding human behavior and the psychology of decision making, tying that back to driving business strategies. Previously, Siddharth was the co-founder and managing director of Servcold India and COO of Center India. Our partner for today's webinar to make the session absolutely possible is BI Worldwide. BI Worldwide is the global leader in engagement solutions that drive measurable results for the clients around the world. In India, they have local offices in Bangalore, Chennai, Delhi, and Mumbai to take care of their employee engagement, employee recognition, and customer engagement initiatives. Over 3 million participants from 125 plus countries have experienced high level of engagement with the products and brands they love, owing to their global capabilities, solutions, and technology systems. We have saved time for you to ask questions at the end of the webinar. For those watching the live session, you can submit your questions at any time during the presentation to the Q&A section. We will try to respond as many questions as time allows. Also, I would like to share something new for you. 5 live attendees of today's webinar will get a chance to win an awesome book, The 12 New Rules of Managing Your Employees, as if they are real people, by New York Times best-selling author Ross Werner. Winners will be announced in the first week of October by email from BI Worldwide. We have an exciting agenda for today's session, so without any further delay, I'm going to hand over the microphone to Siddharth. Over to you, Siddharth.
Thank you, Ritu. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be here to share some exciting work in the area of employee engagement, and thank you so much for taking time to be here today. Over the next 30 to 40 minutes, you will learn about the new trends that are defining what employee engagement means in today's world. Over the past decade, we've seen a few economic cycles, with the Great Recession of 2009 right in the middle. The cycles of employee supply and demand have taken pole position in turns. The employees are gaining that leverage again, and companies need to respond to what they are now looking for if they have to attract and retain great talent. So we set out to find out what the new rules of engagement are that the organizations now need to pay heed to in today's world. But let's pedal back a minute and ask ourselves, why did we need new rules? Many things have changed over the years. People are more individualistic, thrill-seeking, connected, open to sharing. The employee's trust in business is at amongst the lowest points, and the contract between the employer and the employee has taken new meanings than before. The organizations today seem slightly underprepared for what they now have on hands. Seeing the failures of traditional employee engagement models designed for the past, seeing companies struggle to keep up with the changing workforce, the researchers at BI Worldwide went out and asked more pointed and predictive questions of employees around the world. We drew from our experience and the data shared in confidence by many international companies with us. We questioned fundamental assumptions. What emerged from the research, the clear patterns inside those organizations, and what we have seen work, distilled down to 12 imperatives. We call them the 12 new rules of engagement. They address issues of individualization, fearlessness, pay, well-being, and enjoyment of time on the job. They reflect what leaders and managers need to know about transparency, meaning, employees' perceptions of their future, recognition, and teamwork, and how important it is for employees to have the chance to do something incredible. We did this survey a year ago and fine-tuned it further. We sent out to over 7,600 respondents. The feedback that we received from 7,600 respondents across the world in the key countries where BI Worldwide is present, and we collected these responses and did the research based on that survey. This entire empirical work called the New Rules of Engagement will help your organizations gain a competitive edge by creating and sustaining engagement with its employees and reaping the vast benefits that comes with an engaged workforce. So let's go about defining what engagement is. We distilled it down to one human aspect and found it to be at the heart of what engagement stood for, and that is reciprocity. Reciprocity is the human reflex to return what one receives. If you do good, you can expect good, and vice versa. It's a boomerang. We look out for someone who looks out for us. This is equally true in personal as corporate life. You get the engagement you show, and therefore you deserve. Engagement is therefore the investment, the intensity the employees show at their work in reciprocation for the investments their companies make in their experience at work. And that intensity is further defined as a measure of their intensity of performance and intensity of commitment combined. Employees strongly agreeing to the following statements showed a very high degree of intensity. I'm proud to work in my organization and I would recommend it to my friend. That demonstrated a high degree of intensity of commitment. I feel an obligation to work as hard as I can for my company. That showed a high degree of intensity of performance. All questions asked in the survey had a correlation to these statements, which are at the center of reciprocity and provide the key to the degrees of engagement that gave us the new rules. In the rest of the slides that follow you, you will see some statistics with a range of degrees of answers, each of which has a correlation to either intensity of performance or intensity of commitment. So here are the new rules. Get inside their heads. Make them fearless. Make money a non-issue. Help them thrive. Be cool. Be boldly transparent. Don't kill the meaning. See their future. Magnify their success. Unite them. Let them lead and take it to extremes. The new rules are edgy and provocative. Some may be seemingly simple and obvious. Remember, common sense can often fail us, and these again serve as a humble reminder. These rules should form the basis of conversations of what your leadership strategies ought to be and what kind of experiences your employees are having. The rules are levers whose combination is bound to create a tremendous engagement between the employer and the employee. The rules have an order. The first four rules are called the foundation rules. Get inside their heads, make them fearless, make money a non-issue, and help them thrive. They form a foundation for building employee commitment and a culture of performance. Managers cannot hope to garner commitment and performance unless they know their employees' hopes and aspirations. Employees won't commit to an organization that might go under at any moment. And at the end of the day, we all believe in a fair pay, and we cannot do our best if we are not healthy and strike a good work-life balance. Now let's dive in and see what each of these rules are. The rule number one, get inside their heads. Employee engagement, we realized, is an individual phenomenon. All employees are different, different generations, different career paths, roles, aspirations, etc., etc. All individuals are unique, and so are their motivating factors to work more intensely. This rule is the first of all rules and sets the foundation for engagement. I cannot overemphasize the importance of this rule. Every other rule needs to be adapted to the circumstances and personality of the individual worker. And for that, there is only one person who has the time and frequent contact, who is in a unique position to get inside someone's head, to coach, advise, understand, and help him or her succeed. And that is the manager. Only the manager can bring this rule to life. You cannot have an engagement strategy that does not empower managers to do what only they can do. In fact, for that, companies should also recognize great people managers, because that is so rarely done and so conspicuously absent these days. Let's look at this chart for a second. This slide here shows the responses from India. Sorry, if you observe here, employees who've answered between agree and strongly agree to the statement, "My manager understands me," they had a very high correlation, if you see on the left from 0 to 5, to the statement, "I feel an obligation to work as hard as I can for my company," which is the degree of intensity of performance that an employee can show. Again, here, if you would notice, those employees that answered strongly disagree or disagree still came in at slightly neutral, about 3.4, 3.6. This simply means that they're looking at the clock each day to leave home early, or when you put them in front of customers, they will be very transactional, or they're simply there just for the paycheck. Here is another slide that shows the responses from India and the aggregate correlation to either an intensity of performance or an intensity of commitment, both the pillars of engagement and both at the center of reciprocity. The chart on the left shows the range of answers, and the chart on the right shows the aggregate scores of correlation to intensity or engagement for India and the rest of the countries. You will notice the slide for every rule during the presentation. The charts are meant for your observations and information, and while I will talk about some stats, I will not be explaining each chart as we go along, but will present it for your understanding of how India fares on its own and against the rest of the countries. So as I was saying, the key takeaway here is that managers cannot expect performance if they're not going to invest time in knowing what motivates their direct reports better. Rule number two, make them fearless. Once you are inside your employees' heads, it is essential you ensure they're not so distracted or paralyzed by fear that nothing else matters. There is no more primal emotion than fear. It's a survival instinct. We are hardwired to experience and react to it. Because the human brain evolved a powerful fight or flight response against mortal dangers, people struggle to give measured responses to the dangers of a poor performance evaluation, or a boss who yells, or the potential closing of an office or a location. Recession actually only made this worse. Companies hitherto calling the employees as family also laid off workers. You don't do that to families. So let's not even kid ourselves by sugarcoating. The new reality is that the unwritten contract between the employee and the employer has changed. It has become more mercenary, more driven by a bargain cut for the needs of each rather than a long-term working relationship. It's a far less committed relationship between the firm and the worker than before. It's hard to get performance when you know your job is at threat, because fear is a reflex, then choice. People generally have little control over how they react and what its consequences are. The fearful employee may avoid risk, think short-term, becomes a yes man, delays things, does his work begrudgingly, and switches from collaborative to be more competitive. The results from our survey showed a strong correlation to intensity at work when managers used fear as a tool to get work done. However, it was also observed that fear did not have a very strong negative effect at the other end of the scale. It did aid performance. This is probably the reason why fear is still a common tactic that managers use in driving performance and unreasonable deadlines. They're working out of fear as opposed to working out of positive motivation. They're doing this sort of self-preservation rather than thinking for the long term for the organization. So let's not be fooled that if we use fear as a tactic and if it's working in your organization, if people are able to meet their deadlines and meet their targets, it is not necessarily because they're motivated. The new rules research indicates that the performance of those who even survived the layoffs also takes a hit. Creativity, customer focus, sense of obligation to the company, pride in working for it, all run lower than peer companies who haven't laid off workers. Rule number three, make money a non-issue. This is a really interesting trait or a trend that we picked up. Most engagement theorists shy away from connecting pay and engagement, but we felt that this is nothing short of the elephant in the room if not addressed well in the first place. Money is certainly a motivator, but not in the ways people typically believe it does. If you mess it up, it will become an issue, perhaps the number one issue. The most basic fact of money is most of us want more. In India, nearly half the respondents said, I believe I should be paid more money. And another 30% were ambivalent on that statement. That's nearly 80%. But here's the strange thing. The range of answers and their correlations showed that rather being a crucial incentive, it had a surprisingly weak connection to people's drive to work hard. The results showed that people's percentage of delivering at full potential did not vary much from being poorly or well paid or somewhere in between. In fact, a raise doesn't command attention for long. Behavioral economics call it a hedonistic adaptation. It feels great for the first few times you receive your pay or your raise, and then it doesn't feel much different from what you were paid in the previous year just in a few months. But this counterintuitive fact doesn't mean that pay is pivotal, far from it. It plays its part in attracting and perhaps even retaining people. But you have to use something else to motivate them, and that's certainly not money. Employees are expected to look out for the long-term financial goals of their organization. That's a clear, true fact. We expect that from all our employees. But isn't it then unreasonable to expect that the company should look out for the financial goals of the employee too? So when pay is less than competitive, the employees perceive that they're being underpaid. It kicks in a feeling of not being valued. There is a strong correlation to being paid fairly and also finding meaning at your workplace. You may even choose to take up jobs that pay lesser than some other jobs because you find more meaning in it and you love doing that job. In our studies, 38% of employees said their firms are actively helping me reach my long-term financial goals and want me to make more money as the organization becomes more profitable. And among those who strongly agreed to this, less than 4% wanted to defect. And an astounding 92% said their jobs bring out their best ideas, thus proving the real traction compensation can generate when it's fair or even probably when it's slightly more generous. Rule number four, which is the last of the foundation rules, is help them thrive. Employees today are obviously grown-ups. The responsibility for a worker's health rests with the employee. And yet, there is no escaping the fact that a person's job influences his health one way or the other. No one leaves the office at the office, especially when so much of it comes home with you. Therefore, policies, workloads, manager quality, vacation time, and many other aspects of working at a place can either help these employees thrive or can degrade their health. Their psychological well-being, and in turn, the performance of the enterprise. I want to take an example here. SAS software has been in the top 10 of great places to work for the last 11 years in a row. And it's been hovering between being number one to number two to number three, number four, and not really lower down the order. SAS has been winning this for its challenging work, empowering leadership, and great work environment. SAS connects people at an individual level. They provide genuine benefits such as unlimited sick leave, free access to medical practitioners, dietitians, subsidized daycare and preschooling for employees' children. They have just 35-hour work weeks, 5 days a week. The low single-digit employee turnover that SAS experienced last year saved them about $100 million in recruitment and training costs alone. Over 44% of employees in the survey said they had too much work to maintain a healthy lifestyle. India, in fact, fares fairly low amongst all of the countries in this aspect. It should probably come as no surprise if your organization's healthcare premiums are soaring. Another phenomenon that you may all have heard, seen, or been talked to that seems to be on the rise is the organizations now tracking an employee's performance through tracking apps and electronic devices. How many kilometers has she run? What kind of food has he eaten? How many calories did that team burn, et cetera, This data is sometimes even available with peers and other employees who are pitted against the other in group challenges. Sometimes without realizing, such well-being initiatives can violate privacy and dignity of employees. Physical fitness is not a job qualification in most organizations, perhaps in the military, but not in most of the organizations we work for. So why make it such a big deal? However, when well-being initiatives are voluntary, fun, and respectful of people's dignity, coupled with a well-meaning strategy to give people a great experience at work, they will work. If it's coercive and snoopy in a demanding environment with no time to strike a balance, it will simply fail. Let's move on to the next set of rules. The rule number five, be cool. This rule talks to an employee's intensity of commitment to working in an organization. The questions we asked employees ranged from, my organization is a cool place to work. This organization will do exciting things in the future. My organization is open to different points of view. And of course, like all other rules, these questions then demonstrated a very high empirical proximity to my obligation to work as hard as I can for my company and customers, and I'm proud to be in this organization, and I would recommend it to others. When we asked another relevant question of, my job is boring, it ended up being the best predictor of what percentage of full effort people were putting currently delivering in their jobs. In a world where organizations are adapting cool titles such as ninjas, gurus, Jedis, etc., they are pioneering research into driverless cars, and where organizations are encouraging out-of-the-box thinking and channeling the innovators in you without even judging you about the wacky ideas you may have, are the cool places to work. It simply means that these companies are free of discrimination, and then the center of it all, they have a core of authenticity independent of what others are doing. That is really the definition of cool, and not just having parties and, you know, relaxing dress codes. They're all part of it, but that's not the core definition of being cool. For example, you can call Apple a cool company. As Steve Jobs led it with a vision for designing Apple products independently of what the rest of the technology industry was creating. A cool place to work tickles the brain. Time spent there is enjoyable and rarely boring. Coolness fuels innovation. Those who strongly agreed they work in a cool place are 13 times as imaginative as those on the other end of the scale. Coolness is hugely connected to an employee being proud of her job, wanting and planning to stay, and recommending the company to others. It is actually highly profitable to be a cool company. You may have recently read that Infosys just relaxed their dress code. Almost everyone is loosening their ties now, and it's time for those who don't dance or won't sing to make way for the cool generation to take over. Rule number 6, be boldly transparent. People have always communicated with others about their jobs all the time, but never at the speed they do now, nor in many cases with as great an audience that is available to share with. Almost nothing is a secret anymore. It's never been important to run a company so that there's nothing to hide. The last decade was marked by the democratization of the means of publishing and broadcasting unimaginable a generation ago. There are many websites that trade in user-generated content, from restaurant reviews to just about anything you have an opinion on. So is the case with organizations today. Websites such as Glassdoor are at the forefront of shaping the perceptions about working in a particular organization, from the company's policies to salaries and to the CEO rating. Employees are bearing it all. Tipped off by social media, traditional media are discovering new ways to uncover stories about companies that in the past would remain hidden or a secret. A recent example is the online debate on working at Amazon. Now, if a company does not have a solid digital reputation, something that is increasingly getting outside its control, the best hiring prospects evaporate long before they even make contact with HR. So it's that critical now that a company builds its reputation, puts out things more often, and is more transparent with its employees and outside world. Here's an interesting stat. Millennials have emerged with very low levels of social trust. In our surveys we found, and in other research that we collaborated with, only 19% of millennials say people can be trusted, as compared to 31% of Gen Xers and 40% of boomers. When trust levels are so low, silence creates rumors that something is wrong. In the US, 25% employees agreed with the statement that I'm kept in the dark on important issues at my job. Understandably, these employees were far likely to trust their leadership. 53% of this group also agreed with the statement that I wish I were working somewhere else. Transparent firms perform better. To be boldly transparent, a company must communicate with its employees candidly and frequently. Silence is now assumed to mean either the news isn't good or the employees aren't trusted. Trust in the person leading the company is also linked with trust in the company itself. Most CEOs, being used to the old rules, are not prepared for the level of transparency their employees are now beginning to expect. Telling the truth, regardless of how complex or unpopular it is, and engaging with employees regularly is the new imperative. The signals are clear. It's now time to share. Rule number 7, don't kill the meaning. When you ask someone, why do you work, they will probably tell you they needed the money. But if you ask them why they work in their current company or in their current occupation, their answer will include something about meaning. Most people need meaning in their work. Their identity is intertwined with their career and often with their current job. To no other rule in all the 12 rules, people have answered so positively to the questions that reflected meaning. It's a whopping 87% in India. Large majorities in every region believe their jobs are important and see how their work connects to large company goals. The statement, I value my company's mission, was twice as powerful as the statement, I am paid fairly. This is really interesting because money is important. We talked about this before, particularly for signing on and staying. But for daily drive, meaning trumps money. It should come as no surprise when you hear stories of people joining or staying in a company because they believe in the mission. For example, I know some employees who continue to stay in a medical equipment manufacturer because they believe they're saving lives. They believe they're helping cure cancer. And it's not just for the paycheck. They're really associated and strongly have individualized the mission of the organization. Whether someone finds purpose in his or her work is largely a consequence of how the employee is treated, how he or she is made to feel important, how genuinely the leadership talks about the mission of the company. Those who work for exemplary leaders and dedicated managers adopt the mission of the organization. They make it their own. They become personally invested in such goals. When the connection between work and some purpose is severed, work becomes either alienating or sometimes even demeaning. Ultimately, successful leaders and managers are respectful of the deep and different reasons people find purposes in their work and are highly protective of those sentiments and even vigilant against anything that would kill that meaning. If people are familiar with Dan Ariely's work, he has a brilliant exercise called the Shredder Experiment that talks about how strong meaning can motivate people even when it's easy for them to make money. I would highly recommend to read that experiment. Rule number 8, see their future. One theory states that the brain is a prospective organ that is designed to use information from the past and the present to generate predictions about the future. Come to think of it, we're always doing that. We're always, oh, things are like this now, I wonder how it'll be in the future. We're always reminiscing in the past or envisioning what the future would be. One of the most powerful ways to give someone a bright future is to give her a great past and present. Those who are more energized by their past at a company are often more optimistic about their future there. Amongst workers in the US, only a small majority agreed with the statement, I'm excited about my future with this organization. Levels of excitement for and clarity of the future ran much higher for India and China. Both these countries have shown a high degree of clarity in where their future was within the organization. 60% of the time, people's reaction to that statement, this organization will do exciting things in the future, which if you remember was a predictor of coolness, were identical to their response to the statement, I'm optimistic about my future at this company. In the rapidly shortening employee tenures that we are seeing today, employees are increasingly hearing the message, help us build the future of the company, but as for your own future, you're on your own. The reality, however, is that people will continue to invest themselves more heavily in organizations when they see there is a return, when there's a future return for themselves. So organizations have to be careful. Taking away someone's future means taking away his or her present too, and they will find it a mountain of a task to retain such employees. Moving on, rule number 9, magnify their success. This rule ended up having the highest impact on recognition. Companies run employee recognition programs, and magnify their success is the anchor. It is the tell-all of recognition within an organization. There is a neurobiological truth. We all possess a psychological reward center in our heads. It's an area that is activated by dopamine, a compound that controls the brain's pleasure and reward centers. There is a certain amount of dopamine level that the brain is already signaled to expect when something good is going to happen. When we do a good job, we expect to feel a certain amount of good, a certain amount of happiness, a certain amount of joy. That's the level of dopamine that the brain already knows that it will get. Anything below that can create lower engagement. But anything higher creates a phenomenal impact on the individual and creates a much bigger reinforcement of the behaviors or the achievements they just exhibited. As a human nature, people crave dopamine. And no other thing than recognition incredible recognition, in fact, provides that in great measure. Here are some stats. In the UK, as high as 24% of people were skeptical that their good work will be recognized. And about 20% fell in the same bracket in Australia. Those who are least confident in future recognition are 17 times as likely to be leaving as those who are most confident that hard work will be matched with strong praise. If people don't receive the recognition, they will move on. It's like a fisherman finding fish in one part of the river. If he doesn't find anything there, he will move on. Employees are the same. Those who anticipate recognition for their future success feel a great obligation to work hard and give their best ideas to the company. The correlation to those who strongly agree is almost close to 5. This is the highest correlation to any intensity by any other rule, showing the impact of recognition on an employee's obligation to work harder and their intensity of performance is highly, highly intertwined and directly proportional. Recognition again, and I want to bring you back to rule number 1, is a very individual phenomenon. A highly attentive manager who is inside their heads, knowing what kinds of recognition will be most effective, is the only means to ensure the highest levels of motivation for the employees. And this is the only real way to magnify their success. Rule number 10, unite them. You could actually call this teamwork. Although it's been used, abused, has many meanings, but the term team still remains the best description for the complicated collaboration that motivates people and synchronizes their work to accomplish a common goal that they could not otherwise accomplish. For example, like a professional sports franchise, let's say like IPL. Now, IPL, we're always cheering for the team. The players themselves can change regularly. They're either coming, going, but they wear the same shirt and get back, and we're always rooting for them. A company today is similar. It's a group of unrelated individuals recruited to get things done, things that cannot be done alone otherwise. Large majorities of employees across regions agree that there is a strong sense of teamwork in their jobs, that they have strong relationships, and then they get to work with a lot of talented people. There's a very high degree of acceptance of this trend across all regions. And there is a direct relationship between the quantity and quality of collaboration and the degree to which employees say their job brings out their best ideas and how hard they intend to work. Employees' feelings of a strong sense of teamwork are again highly predictive of their customer focus, obligation to the company, and retention within the organization. While employees come together, and this is a really important point, in pursuit of a common goal, it is important to note and to implement and practice that the individuality doesn't have to play second fiddle to togetherness. Even if a team goes all the way to achieve success, a member who cannot claim or who has not been recognized as part and cannot consider this as part of his own resume won't care much about the accomplishment. So it's important for organizations, when they run teams, when they assign goals to teams, to also celebrate individual accomplishments, to unite them together, and to ensure that the accomplishments and the credits are celebrated across the team and also at an individual level, and credit is given where it's due. Getting close, rule number 11, let them lead. There is a large body of research on how important it is for employees to have a say in how their work is done. Employees are more motivated in jobs where their opinions matter. People are more committed to doing things that are at least partly their own idea, rather than having their goals and the way they do their work dictated to them by their managers. 25% of respondents from the US still can't say their ideas are taken seriously or they are given the freedom to do their jobs in the way that best works for them. This is even worse in countries like United Kingdom, Canada, and Australia, signifying that they need to do exactly as they are told. Amongst employees who are not supervisors, huge swings of intensity occur between those who strongly disagree and those who strongly agree that they get a chance to lead. And this is a really interesting point of view, and we are talking about the rank and file, the frontline executives and associates who are not supervising other employees, but when given a chance to lead, and if they agree or strongly disagree that they have that opportunity, their reactions to commitment and intensity were very varied. And I'll give you some of the statistics now. The proportion of people most committed to customer service increased from 7% at the strongly disagree end to 57% when they strongly agreed that they had an opportunity to lead in their work. The proportion of those feeling the greatest obligation to work hard jumped from 3 to 49%. And the number of those who say working at the company brings out their best ideas went from 3% at the strongly disagree end to a large majority of 78% at the strongly agree end, where they felt they had an opportunity to lead in their roles. On the other hand, 74% of people who were deprived of a chance to lead said they wished they were working somewhere else. Interestingly enough, more than most, this rule makes leaders and managers nervous. One of the most important challenges for companies today is how best to balance the employees' need to take greater responsibility without depriving them of the organization structure, hierarchy, and the guidance of a manager. There are some experiments, there are examples of Zappos and Holacracy, if you've heard, where they're splitting the organization into various circles, they're removing titles, there's no more hierarchy in the organization. Well, the jury is still out whether that's working or not working, but from our research, we've realized and we felt that having the manager in place, having the hierarchy in place, is extremely important, and as counterintuitive as it may seem, to give everybody an opportunity to lead, the key to letting people lead actually increases the importance of the role of a manager. They become more involved in knowing the abilities of their people. They have to get inside their heads. They have to know when to give a person more responsibility and when too much responsibility would be setting them up to fail. They have to spend less time directing and more time coaching and take greater accountability for their own people's success. Moving on to the last rule, take it to extremes. Now, this is the last of the rules for a reason. Each of the preceding rules lays the groundwork for the final one. And the ultimate question of an engagement strategy is how well it helps an enterprise and the people who work there reach their full potential. Let's talk about some extremes. If you've heard of tough mudder, you would know what I'm talking about. This is a race that was created by people who are bored of marathons, ultramarathons, and triathlons. This is such an extreme sport that can extend up to 11 to 12 miles, full of obstacles, where even sending electric shocks to you while you're crossing some of the obstacles is part of the routine. You may think this is absurd, but this race started a few years ago only, is now being called a new global phenomenon, and it attracted over 2 million entrants last year alone. And these people who enroll are not athletes. They are not extremists. They are just people like you and me who now represent a larger cultural trend for everyone to be the stars of their own ventures. The trend has powerful implications for the workforce. All those weekend warriors go back to work on Monday morning and they want to do something incredible at their job as well. Organizations are not shying away either. They're asking employees to do something incredible for the enterprise, achieve stretch goals, kill the competition, invent new products, create disruptive business models, and so on. There are two reasons why people will deliver with such intensity. First, if the company has delivered on its end of the bargain and invested in his experience and well-being by adopting all the previous rules well. And second is for their own sense of accomplishment, to earn their bragging rights that they were part of something incredible. Such employees strongly agree to the statements, "I enjoy being challenged to push my limits at work. I believe I can accomplish more in my current organization than I could somewhere else." If you want an engaged workforce, and if you've looked after them with all the other rules, you will have permission from the employee and perhaps even be encouraged to set the vision for doing something that is really, really intense. Now, in a sense of time, I will conclude by saying, and I want to leave some time for Q&A, although I had just two more slides, which maybe I can just quickly run through those. These two slides, we have 12 rules in all, and it sometimes you wonder how do these 12 rules stack up when you're trying to drive intensity of performance and intensity of commitment in India. So this is how they add up. When you see the impact of each of these rules to each of these pillars, you can stack rank them. And if you see here, the top five rules that support driving intensity of commitment in India specifically were: make them fearless, don't kill the meaning, see their future, help them thrive, and be cool. Likewise, those rules that drove intensity of performance were: don't kill the meaning, see their future, take it to extremes, and be cool. In conclusion, I want to leave you with one point that, or a few, if you may: the choice of what kind of attitudes your employees bring to work is ultimately yours to set. These rules together, they constitute a comprehensive rethinking of the strategies for attracting, retaining, and motivating people on the job. And I said this already before, and I'll say it again. The rules of engagement are, these rules should form the basis of conversations of what your leadership strategies ought to be and what kind of experiences your employees are having. These rules are levers, when combined well, can create tremendous engagement and must be implemented in a continual basis, not specifically at an event. They should respond to emotions and not logic, and they should be individual rather than uniform. Thank you very much for listening in, and we can move on to questions.
Thank you so much, Siddharth, for such an insightful session, and we have received a lot of questions from the audiences. So the first one is from Silva. While manager is the most important person in the employee engagement process, we see that managers themselves are highly stressed. How do we engage with managers so that they can contribute to employee engagement?
Well, that's a great question. You may have also heard that people join companies but leave managers. So there is no doubt that managers are under stress. There's no doubt that some managers are but do not find time to spend that one-to-one time with their direct reports. In fact, if you see the image that we used when we talked about the first rule, which is get inside their heads, we used two coffee cups. What we are encouraging companies and our clients to do is to get people to sit face-to-face and have conversations to get to understand each other. There is no replacement to having FaceTime. And I can only suggest and recommend that organizations encourage that and they create an environment. And as I said when I was talking earlier, that we have to start a movement to recognize managers who are good people managers. We don't even attempt to do this enough. We tend to promote people to manager level and give them greater span of control, give them more things to do, more people to manage, but we do not set targets for them or set expectations how well they should manage people. So it is somewhere in the system that is lacking on how we are assigning roles to managers, and we hope one of these rules that I talked about, which is get inside their heads, will provoke you to go back and have these conversations internally and questioning how are managers being recognized and how are they being assigned priorities.
Thank you, Siddharth. This was a wonderful answer. So our next question is from Avik Sen Gupta. Isn't a company overly reliable on its business model and strategy in the market to protect itself is cool to its employees?
It's partly true. I think companies coming in with disruptive business models seem to be more attractive to people who want to join these organizations. They want to be part of something incredible. They want to take things to the extreme. They want to try something different. So it does talk to being cool. But it is not necessary that companies have a unique business model alone. SAS Software, for example, isn't traditional software. It's one of the largest software companies that is still privately held. It is as similar to an SAP or an Oracle, if you may. And if you don't consider them cool, then I would consider SAS to be right up there as a cool company for how it has been doing and how it's been able to retain employees. So it's not just necessarily the business model. It is a combination of several things where employees feel that they have great opportunities to do incredible things in the future, that their company is investing and is encouraging different points of view, and people are allowed to do things without being judged. If you have a good combination of these rules working, the business model could only be one of the ingredients, or there could be several others that can help your company to be a cool company.
Thank you for that. Our next question is from Monica. She wants to know what makes us have these new rules. What she wants to understand is, it is because of Gen Y.
Not necessarily. If you even look at Gen X, there has been a certain trend of individualism that has been happening and that we have been experiencing, and it is not just because the entrance of the millennials or Gen Y. Even the Gen X, for example, or even the baby boomers are adapting. The Gen X has probably started the trend of individualism. For the last 10, 15 years, there's been more of me than we. And that is only getting amplified with Gen Y. So these rules do apply, but perhaps some rules apply more to Gen Y, and some could apply more to the baby boomers or the Gen Xers. It does appeal to all generations in some form or the other. Ritu.
Thank you for that. Our next question is from Atul. Does we have to link employee engagement practices with our business strategy?
Absolutely. I think no employee engagement program or strategy or recognition program should run in isolation. People are motivated by a sense of purpose, a sense of meaning and mission, and your engagement strategy has to dovetail into that. And whatever rules that you define, whatever strategies that you plan out and implement for within your organization should eventually culminate into the organization's mission.
Thank you for that. Our next question is from Priya. She wants to know, money versus meaning may differ for companies and may base on demography. For example, if our company is more than 70% would be Gen Y and generally connect for money and rewards driven, what are your thoughts to deal in such cases?
Ritu, you have to repeat the last part. I didn't follow the question clearly.
Yes, I'll repeat it for you. Money versus meaning may differ for companies and may based on demography. For example, if our company has more than 70% Gen Y and generally connects for money and rewards driven, what are your thoughts to deal in such cases?
Sure. Like I said, money is a motivator, money is important, and money should be dealt with fairly, maybe even slightly generous. But paying more money is not going to buy you engagement. There's enough research to back that money after a point induces stress. Money after a point reduces performance. So money becomes a non-issue irrespective of the generation, as long as they know the organization is dealing with it in a fair and transparent manner, that the employee is being valued and is being given his due credit. But that's where the role of money stops. If in your organization, if or in any organization for that matter, especially with Gen Y, they're just coming into the workforce, money becomes one of a really important and strong motivator in that age and in that period in your career. It is important for the organizations to deal with it fairly and take that off the table. Now, once that is off the table, a whole plethora of opportunities are there to drive meaning at work, to drive fearlessness, to take it to extremes, and so much more.
Thank you for that. Our next question is how we can improve collaboration amongst managers.
One of the best practices that we have seen in implementing several engagement strategies across clients across the world, there's been a tremendous response to training and to learning around what engagement is, how it impacts their own teams, their own groups, and how it helps them succeed if the people who are reporting into them are becoming becoming successful. So we've seen that creating ambassadors who have adopted early enough onto the engagement speak and recognizing them openly, socially, publicly, and sharing their cases and their examples of how they've been able to drive engagement kind of sparks a momentum within the other managers. So we've used training extensively to drive home that point.
Thanks, Siddharth. We are receiving many more questions, but as time is a constraint, so this is the last question I'm shooting at you. This is from Avik. Sure. How to maintain the competition dynamic within the team while trying to unite them to accomplish common goals?
Well, that's a great question. Competitiveness and collaboration is are probably two sides of the coin. Competitiveness is a good thing, but however, it can be bad if competitiveness is driving a selfish goals within an organization rather than the organization goals at large. So driving competition which is healthy and is working towards the longer term goals of the organization should be encouraged, and it's not a bad thing. We are not saying that you have to be only collaborative and not competitive, but competitive becomes bad when it goes to driving your own selfish or greedy goals, and perhaps sometimes even at the cost of pushing other people down. That kind of a competition is unhealthy. Healthy competition is always encouraged.
Thanks for that. Well said. So with this great question answer session, we are going to wrap up today's webinar. Once again, we thank today's webinar partner, PI Worldwide. Finally, our very special thanks to Siddharth, the speaker for this webinar, for his time and invaluable information that he has shared with us today. I would like to thank everybody in the webinar audience for participating in today's presentation. We'll come back to you with many more. This concludes today's webcast. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you.